every writer I know, published or not, feels this pressure to perform an optimism that they don't necessarily always feel. I'm not good at that performance. So instead of like spending a video telling you how great everything is in the publishing world, I thought I would tell you a story about my quest to hold the worst book in the world, about what it takes to become a published writer, and a story about failure. My failure. This is Hannah Whitten. We were part of a writer's group chat back in 2016 that I started. Hannah and I were querying agents at the same time. We got agents within a week of one another, and we were on submission. Our agents were trying to sell our books to editors at the same time. Her dark fantasy, For the Wolf, is out from Orbit Books as of last month. It hit the New York Times bestseller list shortly after. What was being on submission like?
Bad.
It's brutal.
It is truly brutal. I literally don't know anyone at any stage of publishing who's like had a good time with submission, including people that have like sold something and then go on to be like either trying to sell to a different publisher or like waiting to hear back on option material or something. Like, it's terrible for everyone at every stage.
In retrospect, Hannah's success seems inevitable. She's an incredibly talented writer, and she's a great marketer of her book. But it didn't feel that way at the time. We were both struggling with being on submission, and one of the things we would do whenever we struggled was we would talk about what we wanted our book to look like.
I really dig kind of the concept of like viewing a book as an object and like an art piece almost.
Yes.
Which is one of the reasons why I was stoked out of my mind to get Deckled Edges.
Yes! We wanted the Deckled Edge. We wanted the Deckled Edge!
They did that and they did the French flaps, and it just felt strangely like a vote of confidence that they put that much thought into the design of the book.
Even if you don't know what a deckle edge is, I'm sure you've seen it before. When paper is made, they lay plant fiber on top of plant fiber within a wooden frame. The edge is very feathery, and that edge is called a deckle edge. Now, most of the time, the deckle edge is cut off to make this clean edge that you see on most books. But we Americans find a deckle edge really fancy. But it wasn't just how fancy it was. It was imagining the details that would make it feel real to us. So there is definitely a level of desperation to this, but submission, especially your first time on submission, is a desperate time. This is Erik Hane. He's the co-founder of Headwater Literary Management, host of Print Run Podcast, and a talented writer himself. He's also my agent. What's it like working with an author who is having a hard time on submission?
It's hard. I mean, it's hard not necessarily from like a job perspective, because like, you know, you work the process, right? I email the editors, I check in with them, I call them on the phone, I do all those things. Like, it doesn't really change that, but it does. Like, what's hard about it is translating the pacing of that to someone who, I know, it's just like sitting on their hands, right? Like, I feel like submission is really hard for writers because you don't do anything. There's nothing to fix. There's nothing to do. And sometimes in my work, maybe there is, you know, you get a piece of feedback, you can implement it or whatever. But like, it's difficult because it makes people stir crazy. You know what I mean?
Erik has a podcast and he wanted to do like a little comedy bit on his podcast. He put out a call for the worst book we'd ever read. At this point, my inner teacher's pet like started taking over. I don't want to just turn in a bad book. I want to turn in the worst possible book. So I do some furious Googling, and finally I find it. 1940s. I'm gonna have to put it in some text on the screen. Dildo Okay, this was not an obscure book at all. The following year, they made a hit movie out of it called Bahama Passage. Not that much better, but it's better. Why is it called Bilbo K? Bilbo is the name of a cactus. The problems with the book start with the title and they keep going. I'm sitting at my desk at work and I'm having a crappy time on submission. And I know it's petty, but man, I wanted to feel good at the expense of this shitty writer who didn't deserve a book. Now, I do find a physical copy or three on Amazon, but they range between $50 and $150, and my spouse absolutely would not go for that. So I decide to be good instead and start looking for digital copies. Well, there's no, like, Kindle version. They don't have it over at archive.org. It's not scanned into their digital library. They don't have it at a normal library either. It's been out of print for like 80 years. I do find it, however, in a database of archival libraries. I see the first result. It is a quarter mile away. So I go to my boss and say, hey, it's really slow. Can I take a long lunch? And he says, yeah, sure. You can take some leave. And I said, So I head out in 105 degree July heat to the Harry Ransom Center attached to the University of Texas Library. And I walk up to the receptionist on the second floor and I say, I would like to check out a book. And she says, okay, you can't check out a book traditionally here. It's an archival library. Their job is to keep books that would otherwise decay into nothing safe. So I tell the librarian, okay, I only have a little bit of time. I'm trying to do this on my lunch break. She says, okay, gotcha. You go take the training. I'll go get the book. And I said, thank you. And she said, what's the book? So I write it down. I chickened out on saying it aloud. I couldn't do that to myself or anyone else. But she is a complete professional about it. God bless her. And I go look at this video that tells me to put this book on a little velvet wedge so that the spine doesn't crack, that kind of thing. And when I come out, the librarian ushers me into the reading room. And this place is a trip. There are three PhD students looking at beautiful drawings, looking at letters. See, as an archival library, this place doesn't just store books, it stores famous sketches by artists. This particular library holds the letters of a couple of famous authors, including David Foster Wallace, which is a big deal. So I start really feeling the gravity of the place I'm in, like almost the sacred nature of the space. And I start reflecting on myself as a writer and my dreams and where I fit into this, if anywhere. See, I had just gotten the news a couple of days prior that an editor had really loved my book. But when they showed it to their boss didn't get it. And I felt in my bones at that point that the book was probably dead. We'd been on submission over a year. This is H.C. Marks, a friend of mine. He's got a YouTube channel, he's got a newsletter, he self-published a book, and he has a couple of podcasts. He's also the sole writer behind Aaron Mankin's Cabinet of Curiosities, which just cracks the top 100 most popular podcasts. But he's always wanted to be a traditionally published novelist. What's it like not to get to hold your book?
It hurts. It feels... it sounds cliche, but it feels like there is like a hole here. It's not like I just decided one day. Well, it is like I just decided one day to write a book and to see how it would go. That was 10 years ago. Now, because I have really focused on doing that as either a side career or just pursuing it more seriously and more professionally, it hurts more. Because I want it so badly, or I wanted it so badly. And I, every time I go through this process of querying, I come out of it like, this is it, I can't do this anymore. Like, I can't take this heartache anymore.
The road to success and the road to failure run parallel. And we always look inside of ourselves, at least I know I do, at what I could have done differently. If I could have just been more positive, maybe I could have stuck it out longer. But that's not how it went. finally, with 20 minutes to go before I had to leave to go back to work, they got the book to me. And the first thing I notice about it is it has a decal edge. And suddenly, this completely stops being a joke. And there are other things about the book that are absolutely beautiful as well. It has this bright pink embossed flamingo that is still brilliant 80 years after it was made. And the texture of the cover is like canvas. It's really a unique thing to older books that is just a joy to hold. So I open the book up to the very first page and I start reading. They couldn't be cranes, he thought. Not with heads like that. He was leaning on a windowsill in his bedroom. In the distance, a line of low, irregular sandhills stood out against the sea. That was all there was from Adrian's window, except on the far side of a dike, out on the ponds, two bird-like objects, so close together as to almost be one. They couldn't even be birds. Birds kept to the weaker ponds. It was impossible that they were birds. Adrian went into a sweat, trying to make them, if not bird, then anything, anything but the legs and feet of a dead man. So, maybe Nelson Hayes didn't deserve a book. You have to understand, in order to get through a draft of a book, even if it's a bad book, even if it's one that doesn't deserve to exist, he went through that draft multiple times, revising and refining the thing. And then he had to convince other people it was good. He had to probably convince an agent, certainly convince an editor to take it on. And then hundreds of people worked on the thing, like paper millers, printers. Audiences had to love the book, and they did. There was a movie of this. Nelson Hayes's letters are kept at Yale the way David Foster Wallace's are kept at the Harry Ransom Center. This was a beloved book and a beloved author, and then we moved on. There's a book called Cruel Optimism by Lauren Berlant, which says that in capitalism, we experience pressures to be optimistic, even when that optimism is detrimental to our success. So while I understand that we have to keep a persona up as just protection a lot of the time, I hope you will, if you're a writer, give yourself the space to be sad once in a while, because this was one of the most moving experiences of my life, and I wouldn't trade it for anything.